had an experience where all of this death life, we call the universe, all this activity was like faded into black and white, and then faded into just shadowy silhouettes, sort of dark silhouettes. You couldn't tell what was going on. It's like, okay, I was just watching this. And so it was like my dreams just faded into this. And I was just saying, well, that's fine, it's not a problem. So all the color was gone, the activity, it was just kind of a hodgepodge of dark silhouettes, no detail to it whatsoever. And you just realize, I can't really focus on this or what's going on. I don't know. It was okay. So just shocked by fading death lifing. Wow. So we could say that, just shocked by fading death lifing. Wow. Just allowing fading death lifing. Wow. Just accepting fading death lifing. Wow. Just delighting in fading death lifing. Wow. Just loving fading death lifing. Wow. Just abiding in fading death lifing. Wow. Just fading death lifing. Wow. Just fading death lifing. Wow. So this is an auspicious occurrence. I realized that. I said, okay, this getting somewhere here, getting somewhere. I don't know if it's too little too late or what, but still trying the best we can. Just fading death lifing. Wow. Just fading death lifing. Wow. We don't have to kill death lifing. Just fade it. Just fade it out of the picture. So I just remained in this state where there was really no mental imagery or thinking going on at all, except just a totally, extremely faded. It was extremely faded, you might say. It was still taking place, but very faded. Drab, you know, no color in it, no detail in it. The outlines were even kind of blurry. It was just being faded out and defocused and faded out. Not scary. It's just okay. This is interesting. So just fading, just loving fading death lifing. Wow. Just loving fading out death lifing. Wow. Just loving fading out death lifing. Wow. Just loving fading out death lifing. Wow. So this is in conjunction with the advice and experiences of that we've had from our great spiritual coaches the defocusing and fading out of your attention on this pretending, this pretension we call death-lifing or universing, it's really death-lifing, which is just an imaginary future that we are claiming we're using to help the Prime Creator wake up to its future, which is one of limitation and ruination we claim. So we're just using this as a prop to try and help the Prime Creator over its fear. We think the Prime Creator is afraid to face its future. So we're saying, here, let us help you out. We're going to show you what your future is really like here. A nice facsimile, kind of a play on it. So you'll get a good idea what it's like. The Prime Creator doesn't have any future different than the present. This eternal present is the Prime Creator in reality. So all this is not necessary. This death-lifing play that we're putting on. And in the world, we seem to be told that, hey, we got to choose between science and religion, or maybe both science and religion. No, I got news. It's neither science nor religion. Both of them are not even in the ballpark at all. They're not even in the ballpark. Traditional religion, science, religion, they're not in the ballpark at all. So we don't. Neither one is the truth. They're way off, completely off, not in the ballpark. So, you know, it's we really choose between truth and lies. We really choose between truth and lies, between grace and paranoia, between grace and paranoia. That's what we're choosing between. So, how about that? That's very, very profound to realize this and hear this. That it's okay to say we don't have to have either one of those, science or religion. Absolutely not. They're both very off track, very, very off track. Again, this universe, this spirit's attempt to coax the prime creator into supposedly waking up out of a dream of perfection, eternal now perfectioning, and recognizing what its true reality is like, which is one of limitation and ruination, and that the prime creator is having trouble doing this because it's afraid to do this. But so we're helping it out by showcasing something quite similar to its supposed reality. This and we're doing this in an attempt to get the prime creator to self-destruct, and that in seeing its reality, supposedly of ruination limitation, they'll say, I must suffer ruination, and that it will self-destruct. This is what we're doing it for. So neither science nor religion ever say anything about this whatsoever. They avoid it like the plague, because we believe we have to get the prime creator to self-destruct, or else we won't be able to function and we won't have a reality at all, because we believe the prime creator is defective. Mistakenly, that's a mistake. That's the key mistake that we made. When we tried to experience being prior to the prime creator, we couldn't experience that. We felt the prime creator was blocking us from experiencing it. No, it was just because there's no way to experience what's prior to reality. So we felt the prime creator was defective, was against us, and we needed to replace it. So we started dreaming of this scheme to figure out a way to do that. And again, it's funny, we keep trying to say we're trying to enlighten ourselves. We're really trying to enlighten the prime creator. So this is a great breakthrough that happened, I think, on the 23rd or 24th of July of 2022. Suddenly I saw this and I said, it's not, none of this is about our enlightenment. This whole idea that we're supposed to be enlightened is completely off track. We're trying to enlighten the prime creator. We think the prime creator is sleeping. It's dreaming of a perfect now. That's not a bad dream to have, right? I'd say if you have a dream of perfect now, you might want to keep that. But it's not dreaming at all. But we claim, oh no, prime creator, yeah, that perfect now that you're dreaming of, that's just a dream. That's not reality really at all. Reality is this really, you know, terrible death-lifing situation, limitation, ruination, everything subject to doom. But that's what your reality is really like. That, but you need to wake up to it, because you know you got to face reality. Come on, come on, Jack, face reality. And so we're trying to enlighten the prime creator, trying to wake it up. It's not asleep though. Prime creator is not asleep. It's not dreaming. So all our efforts at enlightenment are futile. So we've redefined the entire situation here. So we can say that all efforts towards enlightenment are entirely futile, because enlightenment has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with our belief the prime creator needs to be enlightened. So when we can accept the prime creator doesn't need to be enlightened, then we can drop our attempt to try to enlighten the prime creator, which means we don't need to keep focusing in all this detail and vividness about this pretensional play of limitation and ruination, you know, impermanence. People have called it impermanence. This horrible dream of deathing, life deathing, really, because in order to have death, you have to have life that dies, right? It can't be the death of nothing. It has to be the death of something that we feel was different than death. You know, in other words, there's something called life, life death. It's death, death lifing. So we've completely flipped the script and turned the tables on the entire situation here. That's happened over the last few days. I think it started on the 23rd of July, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. It's like 9 days, or we call it like 8 days, but it's just a little over a week. 8 days a week. Speaking of that, 1965, what was the number one song right now? Still Satisfaction by the Stones, going into August of 65. The Beatles had 5 number one songs in 1965. What did I Feel Fine, Ticket to Ride, 8 days a week. Was it Help? And Yesterday. All my troubles seem so far away. Yeah, that one. Now it seems I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. But we don't believe in yesterday. We don't. We don't believe in today or tomorrow. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We don't believe in any of that. Because we realize all of this time, place, yesterday, today, and tomorrow scenario is, again, just our play acting. We're play acting roles, volunteering to play act roles to try to enlighten the prime creator. So this has never been talked about. It has never been talked about, but we're talking about it now. And so this is why these times are the most auspicious times, I think, in history, because they're the worst times in history. I'm getting more and more and more aware of what's going on in the world, and you realize it is just an absolute dystopian nightmare. You can't even believe it. The rabbit hole is so deep. You know, people just can't go down far enough. They just go, you know, forget it. It is just Orwellian beyond belief. You know, deep fake stuff going on that is just holy cow. Just all being, you know, Hollywood is basically running, you know, the effects, special effects. There's all this stuff going on, which people say, hey, wait a minute, you know, something isn't right here. What the heck is going on? They say, I don't want to know. People don't want to know. I don't blame them. Really, right? Because it's like, we're in some sort of dystopian nightmare. But again, none of this has anything to do with us. We're trying to enlighten the prime creator. So this is a completely different way of looking at the whole scenario that we're engaged in. So we're in really good shape right now. Now, it's not easy. It's kind of like aftershocks are hitting me like, wow, you know, this is intense. But we have this totally fresh new perspective on the entire situation, our whole existential situation here. And so people are talking about now nothing's worked. You know, I've tried everything, all these teachings, I'm still deluded and blah, blah, blah. Hey, there's still extreme amount of hope here because we have a very different explanation for what's going on that is way more helpful, I believe, than what we've had in the past. Way more. And that's the whole idea, is to get extreme amount of helpfulness during these extremely dystopian, terrible times that we're in right now, where it's just gone into the twilight zone. Seriously. The whole situation's in the twilight zone right now. And people don't want to even think about it. Understandably so. Who wants to? So we're focusing on this amazing spiritual breakthrough we've had. It took 65 years of just started from the day I was born, just intense effort, nonstop every day, to be able to flip the entire script, historic and future, of what the heck's going on here in this universe. And we're saying this universe is our spirit's attempt to enlighten the prime creator. Total flip. Amazing. Absolutely terrific. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, as I would like to say. And all the spiritual coaches for you know, helping us get to this point. Wow. And we're not used to it, so we're like kind of like, wow. But if you look at it, you say, holy cow, this really fits, doesn't it? It really fits. So it started out on this February 10th, 2021, where I had this terrific revelation that showed we're all volunteering to play roles in this scheme to try to convince the prime creator to self-destruct. That this everything that's going on here is voluntary. That's the first thing. Voluntary. We're playing roles, role-playing. We're just acting, role-playing. And this is a scheme or a program that we've been working on, designing, testing, assessing, to try and find a way to get the prime creator to self-destruct. So that was the revelation, and it just shot kaboom, and I realized, wow. You know, nothing's going to be the same from this point on. And it hasn't been. Seeing this, I had to rework everything. And now, then on the 23rd, 24th of July, this suddenly I realized, oh, we're trying to enlighten the prime creator is what we're trying to do. We're trying to deceive it by claiming we have something magnificent for it. Enlightenment, realization. of reality. Wake up to reality, Prime Creator. You've been dreaming. You've been sleeping. You're going to love reality because it's so much more real than what you're doing. It's really real. No, it's really make-believe. Our make-believe. It's just our make-believe. So the Prime Creator is not falling for this trick at all. Not at all. It knows it doesn't have any future. Okay, it's only that it knows that eternal perfection is not its dreaming. It's not asleep. That it's reality. But we're trying to convince it otherwise. He says, you know, it's a hard road, Prime Creator. We understand. You know, enlightenment's tough. You really got to make a lot of efforts on this road. But eventually, you know, you'll get there. You'll wake up and you'll realize, oh my gosh, you know, here's all this limitation, ruination. And this is reality. Oh my gosh, how do I function here? Oh, gee, I don't think I can. I'm going to be ruined. Oh boy. You know, this is what it's all about. So, I've stopped any involvement with the teachings of the past. I've had to do so because this is so different now. It's completely flipping things in a certain way, which the old stuff just doesn't fit well. It doesn't fit well with it anymore. So it was kind of like, wow, okay. But it's very doable. It's been seen very clearly, and it gives us a completely fresh outlook, completely fresh outlook. And so it takes away the blues. It takes away feeling like we just can't make it. You know, we're just, I don't know why I can't be enlightened. You know, it's not about our enlightenment at all. We don't need to be enlightened. Nobody needs to be enlightened. That's completely off track. We just need to give up, relinquish our attempts to enlighten the Prime Creator. Now, Ram Maharshi spoke of this not directly like we are, but it was certainly there. He emphasized, it was his emphasis. He was helping shift the emphasis for us. So he was the pivotal spiritual coach, I would say, that we've had. You could feel the way that he was shifting the emphasis. Had to do it carefully, you know. He said, look, it's not about attaining anything whatsoever. You don't need to attain. You already are that. You just need to relinquish your efforts, you know, of call it, well, thinking or something. But it didn't delineate it entirely. But the emphasis was there. So that's what's important. It's the emphasis that he put on the situation. He said, hey, wait a minute, you know. So I'm studying around Maharshi my whole life. I always say, what is he getting at, you know? And you look at the traditional spiritual religious teachings and you say, he doesn't quite seem to be getting at that. You know, there's something that's just not, I don't know what's going on here. But now we can see how he was shifting the emphasis away from, he says, you don't need to be enlightened. You're already what you are. So he says, basically saying, give up enlightenment, give up efforts to be liberated, give up any thinking or scheming whatsoever, and you will find you're already the self, you're already that. That was his emphasis. So he pivoted the emphasis away, and I'm saying, I could have never gotten to this without Ram Maharshi doing what he did. You know, he shifted the emphasis. Wow. And then, of course, in Miracles, Jesus also dropped a whole lot of hints about this, You know, he still had to cater to the sensibilities of the times and previous teachings somewhat, but he was also shifting the emphasis. He was shifting the emphasis also. So I was saying, wow, what are they getting at here? I didn't know. I wasn't quite sure what they're getting at here. But intuitively, I said, there's something, you know, there's something big shift we need to make here. An emphasis. And so it happened on the last week of July in 2022. This happened over 3 days. Boom, boom, boom. Boom like that. It's like, wow. Yeah, forget about our enlightenment. We don't need enlightenment. We just need to stop trying to enlighten the Prime Creator. That's that simple. It's that simple. So we've got this profound new stance. You see, we're not having to defend religion or science at all. We're off both of those. So all this Sturm und Drang struggle between science and religion. They're both out the door. They're both out the door. Totally out the door. We're not interested in that anymore. Which, you know, probably feels very liberating. It's so simple. We don't have to be enlightened. Forget about enlightenment. We forget about it. We'll just realize we don't need to try and enlighten the Prime Creator. The Prime Creator doesn't have a future to wake up to. Prime Creator is not asleep. It's not dreaming. It's not deluded. It's not in ignorance. We don't need to pull the Prime Creator out of ignorance. We don't need to do anything with the Prime Creator. It's still completely flawless. It doesn't have any future other than just this continuation of the eternally perfect, the perfect eternal now. That's always its past, present, and future is always the same. So there's no reason to delineate past, present, and future. There's no conceptual need to delineate that. And it doesn't. So it doesn't need to awaken. We don't need to awaken the Prime Creator. And so it's like, so we're just letting this sink in. This is letting it sink in. Wow. And you know, we have to go over this and emphasize it. And it's a transitional period, as we say, it's a transitional period we're in right now. That's for sure. That's for sure. Everybody's still focusing on enlightenment. I mean, you look at hundreds and thousands of groups and efforts, and everybody's, you know, just grinding away on enlightenment and how can I be happy and all this kind of stuff. And it has been going on forever. And how many of us have really gotten to this so-called enlightenment? Rama says, no, give all that stuff up. That's the problem. That's all mind. He said, that's all mind. That's just thinking. That's conceptualized. That's just mind. He says, beyond the mind is the ever-present reality. And nothing needs to happen to that. You don't have to make any changes in reality whatsoever. So he says, this whole thing about striving for enlightenment is totally delusional. That is the delusion. All your striving, all your effort, including all this effort towards enlightenment, is the delusion. But we certainly do need to clarify this situation. That effort and clarification is necessary. And Ron would say, yes, of course you need to put a lot of effort and practice into clarification, but not into enlightenment, into clarification. That we don't need enlightenment. We don't need enlightenment. We're still perfectly spirit, perfect. And reality doesn't need enlightenment. So what needs enlightenment? Again, our mistaken belief that the Prime Creator needs enlightenment, that it's defective, and it's a tricky way of trying to get it to self-destruct, is what's really going on. So, yeah, hard sell, because nobody's expecting this. Nobody's expecting this. Just like, nobody's expecting all the shenanigans that's going on with the public relations being used right now. There's some real phony baloney stuff taking place. It's just amazing what's going on with the federal government, the White House. People are starting to notice, hey, you know, what are they using, a body double here or something? I mean, what's going on? Something is not right at all. Different faces, different ear configurations. Obviously, it's not the same person, you know? And everybody sweeping that under the rug. Just sweeping it under the rug. It's like, nothing to see here. Just lighting effects. Really? Different ears? You know, they're supposed to say this is the president. And you compare the ears, like the earlobes and stuff like that. Just, they got different ears. And you look at the eyes, different eyes. You look at it, say, wait a minute. You know, they're not blinking. So wait a minute. You know, you look at one video and it's, okay, that's normal. And look at this one. Said, this is not him. This is not him, actually. It's CGI, some sort of CGI. They're using deep fake, you know, they're using digital techniques. You know, they've got the production wizards from Hollywood working in the White House, and they're using special effects and digital techniques to mislead the world. Actually, you know, it's a fantasy land that's going on. Something's, you know, just very bizarre, and people don't want to know about it. This is said, this is too much for me. But the nerve of these people to do that, you know, the nerve of these people, wow, that's why we don't like them. I've never liked Hollywood. That's putting it mildly. Because they're experts at fakery. They're experts at fakery. They love to fake it. They say, why have it real if you can fake it? So they're obsessed with fakery, right? And that's, I don't like that at all. I'm totally focused on what's real, not fakery. And they say, well, maybe, you know, if they could fake reality, they would do so. You know, they say, well, that's, who needs reality? Let's try to fake it instead. That's crazy. So I love transparency and honesty and transparency and no fakery. And right now it's just the opposite of that. It's extremely duplicitous. Tons of digital fakery is going on. Voice alteration, face alteration, you know, just green screening, you know, or blue screening, green screening, however they're using it. Handlers, you know, you don't know what's going on, what kind of drugs are being used. And the whole thing is just like, you know, just bizarre, you know, completely bizarre. And people are losing their morale because of that. The country is losing its morale and confidence. They said, you know, they say, kind of, everyone knows, like, well, you know, something weird is going on here. There's a sense of weirdness. Well, it is weird what's going on. So that's, the world is very weird right now. And more and more weird, because, you know, this, the amount of digital fakery that's going on in the world is extreme. You can just put someone's face on some other body, and you can generate words that they never said. And so you think, just, you know, anything could be fake. You don't know what's real anymore. So that's why giving up this attempt to enlighten the prime creator is a really good idea right now, and to become aware of what is truly real, which is reality. That's why I call it reality. It's unchanging, perfect, eternal nowing. Unchanging, perfect, eternal nowing. Wow. Just an unchanging, perfect, eternal nowing. Wow. And again, people have don't want to deal with weirdness, so they're just going to just you know, let's just eat, you know, drink and frivolity. And it's like the Titanic. Yes, we don't want to think about icebergs. You know, it's just forget it. Understandable, very understandable. Just a little goes a long way. And you notice it, and you say, okay, now let's get back to business here. And that business is this terrific shift in emphasis, as towards our clarification at this point. No one's been able to answer, why are we thinking in the first place? Why do we have all these concepts? Why are these bundle of thinkings and habits? Why did this ever happen in the first place? And people, the traditional spirituality will say, everything you're doing now is based on past thoughts and memories. I say, okay, great. So those past thoughts and memories happening in the past, what were those based on? Right? Well, they say, well, those are also based on past memories and thoughts. Okay, and what were those based on? And so you got an infinite regression here. They're not really answering the question at all. They're just giving you this infinite regression. So if right now is based on past thoughts and memories, and we have these thoughts and memories now, you know, what were those previous thoughts and memories based on? See, there's no answer to it. They're not answering the question. They had to come from somewhere, the thoughts and memories. What's the original thought? Well, the original thought supposedly is I. But what's that based on? You know, and then memories of I, and then, you know, it's murky. You know, it's very murky. If you look at it carefully, the explanations are extremely murky in the past. Here, we have no murkiness at all. It's completely clear that everything started when the spirit had this idea of being prior to the prime creator. This idea cannot be experienced. The prime creator says yes to every idea, unqualified yes, unconditional yes, instant unconditional yesing. Wow, that is reality. But we chose this idea of trying to be prior to this unconditional, all-inclusive yesing, and you can't be prior to that. So we didn't feel any experiencing, and then we said, hey, the prime creator didn't say give this unqualified instant yes to this. Well, it did, except there's no experience involved with this idea. So we didn't get that. And we said, wait a minute, Prime Creator said no. Or delayed it, wouldn't agree to the, you know, what, something's wrong with the Prime Creator. We said, wow, something's totally messed up. Oh my God. And so then we said, okay, we got to fix this. And but we said, the only way to deal with this is really to get the Prime Creator to self-destruct, because it's in total denial that it has this problem. We got this feeling like it totally denies that it has this problem. That's because it doesn't have a problem. But we made a mistake in saying the Prime Creator has a problem. And then we said, well, the Prime Creator is totally denying this. So we got to get rid of the Prime Creator. It's defective, super defective. So then we started pretending, playing, volunteering to play roles and to build up a scheme to trick the Prime Creator into self-destruction by telling the Prime Creator that it is actually asleep and ignorant and deluded and dreaming of an eternal perfect now, except there isn't any such thing at all. And we say, well, you know, you may think there is, but it's backloaded with limitation and ruination. You got this future. You just don't realize that yet. So we're trying to get the Prime Creator to wake up and be enlightened about what the nature of reality really is like, which we are portraying it. This universe is a portrayal of what we're trying to get, convince the Prime Creator that its future is really like this and needs to realize this and wake up to it and accept it. Okay, that's what we're trying to do. And the Prime Creator doesn't have any problem at all. It's not defective. It doesn't have any future. Doesn't have any limitation, ruination. This is just, you know, our scheme to freak it out, freak the Prime Creator out so it self-destructs, so that we can get rid of a defective Prime Creator. So that's the clear explanation of why we're so-called thinking, which is really just scheming. We remember have memories of the past because we are keeping track of what have we tried to wake up the Prime Creator, so we can say, well, that didn't work, so let's try something different. So, you know, all this data we're collecting and of the past, it just has to do with the various experiments and various roles what we've acted out in an attempt to get the Prime Creator to be enlightened, so to speak. And so, you know, that's what's really going on. We're assessing, you know, well, this didn't work in the past. You know, how many times have we tried this? Okay, let's try something a little different, or let's make it more intense, or a little less intense, or try a little spin this way. Let's modify it this way. So we're constantly modifying it based on previous experience of, hey, it didn't quite work, hasn't worked yet. You know, maybe let's not keep doing the same thing over and over. Maybe we should just keep repeating over and over, or, you know, that kind of thing. You know, we're just assessing, constantly assessing. This is thinking. It's assessing, designing, testing, assessing our scheme, our program to enlighten, to wake up the Prime Creator to what we believe is its real reality, which is, you know, totally defective. It's just limitation and ruination, which we hope will freak it out to the point of self-destruction. So that answers all these vague postulates that we've had in the past that didn't, you know, what's wrong with us? Well, we're thinking, why are we thinking? Well, we're thinking about memories of the past, you know, memories that just get rid of all this memory, drop all your memory, live in the now. So why do we have these? Where do these memories of the past come from? Well, they came from also memories of the past. And just, you know, goes on infinitely. There's no answer there. There's no answer at all. It's like giving an answer is not an answer at all. But we're just lazy, so we say, I don't want to even think about that infinite regression. It freaks me out. It's a freak out answer kind of thing, infinite regression. You know, when did it start? When did memory start? Memory of what? Right? Memory of what? It's not. It started with a false attribution, a mistake we made. Not a memory, but a mistake. So the genesis of all our scheming is a mistake that we made. We said the Prime Creator is defective because we thought we could experience being prior to the Prime Creator, and there isn't any such experience to be had. There is no such thing as prior to reality. And so we felt that there must be some experiencing of this. And because there's experiencing of every other idea, so we naively thought that we should be able to experience this too. And when we couldn't, we mistakenly said the prime creator blocked us from experiencing this, and went into denial that it did this. And so then there's an antagonism. We felt the prime creator is defective and is working against us and doesn't really support us. And that's the genesis, that's the beginning of all our play acting. You know, really, it's not even thinking, it's play acting. You can say it's thinking or thoughts. I don't know what they mean by thoughts. That's just scheming. It's like, hey, maybe this will work. I think this will work. Let's try this. It's basically saying, you know, maybe this will work. Let's try this. Well, you tried that before. Oh, yeah, I remember that. I tried that before. Well, you know, maybe we need to modify it a little bit, kind of thing. If we didn't have memory, we just have no clue about how to structure, you know, how to modify what we're doing, structure and modify it, because it's not working yet. So we feel we have to modify it in some way. We don't want to just repeat what we've done before unless we believe that repetition itself will succeed. And so there's both of that. There's both modification and repetition taking place, both of those things, because we're trying to throw the kitchen sink at the situation. But in truth, again, we don't need enlightenment at all. Like Rama said, it's nothing you gain afresh or anew at all. Not in the slightest bit. So we're saying just give up. Relinquish, gracefully relinquish. Turn our scheme over to the Holy Spirit. Turn our futuring over to the Holy Spirit. Turn our attempt to enlighten the Prime Creator over the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit knows the Prime Creator doesn't need to be enlightened. It also knows that we've been engaged in this attempt for so long that if we stop, we're afraid we won't be able to function at all in reality. So it's capable, it's uniquely capable of giving us a futuring. It says, let's sell the Prime Creator on this future. That'll make it easier. So the Holy Spirit will say, sure. Okay, let's sell the Prime Creator. Let's enlighten the Prime Creator by this tactic. You're trying to show it limitation and ruination. Why don't we show, you know, no limitation or ruination? A dream of that, or act out like, and then that would be real lot closer to what the Prime Creator is used to experiencing, you know. And then once we say, okay, then when we get to that and experience that, we start experiencing this feeling of perfectioning. And we think, oh, that'll sort of, you know, help the Prime Creator start easing its way past its paranoia towards awakening. What we find out is we get used to that and we say, hey, wait a minute. This is so similar to reality. It would be easy for me to just accept reality the way that it is. And easy to admit, like, hey, I just made up this whole fantasy of a Prime Creator having a future. And then we say, oh, I don't even pretend that we have pretend this game of futuring at all. I don't even pretend to try. I don't even need to keep trying to enlighten the Prime Creator. I feel so close to reality right now. Easy to give it up. Easy to give it up at that point. But it's real difficult right now in the world, especially now, because everybody's really putting on a huge, intense play of limitation and ruination. But the Holy Spirit tells us, like, hey, you know, how's that going to work? So the Holy Spirit's very pragmatic. Is it, how's that? This honestly, how do you think that's going to work? That's like totally different than what the Prime Creator's used to experiencing. You don't expect the Prime Creator to just jump into this. Come on, that's stupid, which it is. So it says, let me be in charge of this effort to enlighten the Prime Creator. Okay. Now, again, the Holy Spirit knows the Prime Creator doesn't need to be enlightened, but it also knows that we're so addicted to this effort that we can't give it up directly. We just can't give it up directly like that. So the Holy Spirit will again say, let's come up with this so-called future that's extremely similar to what the Prime Creator is experiencing with this perfect eternal nowing. Let's come up with something real. I can present something to the Prime Creator that's really similar, very close. You see, now that's being wise, right? And we say, yes, Holy Spirit, that's true. That's very wise. We see the wisdom of your ways. But we also subconsciously we realize, hey, you know what? If I get used to this, it's something that's really close to reality, it would be a really easy step to take to just drop the whole scheme at that point. It wouldn't be traumatic at all. It wouldn't be frightening at all. You see that? You see this? So Holy Spirit has to kind of play this game with us, and knowing that this works, knowing that this works, we will say, oh, okay. Yeah. I feel so close to reality right now. Easy step. I can see, I made a mistake. I admit I made a mistake. I forgive myself for making that silly mistake. The Prime Creator is defective. I realize there's nothing to reason to try and enlighten the Prime Creator to some future. It's different than the perfect eternal nowing. So, but it's easy to just step right into perfect eternal nowing from the kind of feeling that I'm used to right now. So this is how I see, there's a very nice way of structuring how we can be helped right now, how we can be helped. Just turn off futuring over the Prime Creator. Just shock by Holy Spirit playing playing my role in futuring. Wow. Just shock by Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. So just shock by Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. So this practice is basically saying, I'm going to turn my role playing in futuring over the Holy Spirit. It'll play my role for me. And it'll play a role bringing about this experiencing, which feels very close to eternal, perfect eternal nowing. It'll feel very close to that. It won't be exactly the same, but it'll feel very close. It's like a facsimile, a very, very good facsimile. And then, but without, I don't have to relinquish, you know, the purpose of futuring yet. I don't have to. I can still say, well, maybe this helps the Prime Creator ease out of its dreaming, you know, so to speak. It's like that. So it's not in violence. It doesn't try to tear you away from everything that you're used to. You're still allowing role-playing to take place. You're still allowing futuring to take place. It's just a different tact, taking a different tact. And instead of trying to make it very dissimilar, which we're doing right now, the world's trying to make it seem really, really full of limitation, ruination, doom, suffering, misery. Instead of doing that, which is completely dissimilar to reality, do something that's extremely similar to reality. That's just a wise thing to do, just in case we actually need to do this. But of course, in the back of our minds are saying, you know what, probably we don't even need to do this futuring at all. So it would be really advantageous position to experience something really close to reality, and the Holy Spirit's able to do this, rather than this ridiculous show that's going on right now in the world. But most people are clinging to this show right now in the world. They're just pumping up the volume on it, you know, 24/7. And it's just, you know, it's a circus. It's an absolute clown show that's going on. Orwellian clown show, and it's so distasteful. But the people think, you know, this will wake the Prime Creator up. You know, it'll shock. It's like shock treatment for the Prime Creator. That's what they're doing. This world right now is like shock treatment. We're really trying to find some sort of treatment that we can give to the Prime Creator to wake it up out of its delusion that all there is eternal, perfect eternal nowing. So it's like this is shock treatment, brutal shock treatment for the Prime Creator. And we're saying, you know what? That's like extremely unlikely to work. Even if we needed to have it work, it's this is just like really dumb, really stupid way to go about it. You'd want to ease the Prime Creator past his paranoia if that's the situation. We're not saying it is. We're saying it might not even be that situation at all. But let's hedge our bets, turn our futuring over to the Holy Spirit. Just loving Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. Just loving Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. Just loving Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. Just loving Holy Spirit playing my role in futuring. Wow. So if you want to get a very more optimistic perspective on our situation, this is the place to get it. This is the place to get us, because we're very clear about this and we're able to speak about it and explain it. When, you know, in good spirits and humorous spirits, and we're not all, you know, defeated and wiped out and moping around. It hasn't been easy, this shift, but not that difficult. I've just had some times where I've just kind of been flat. I felt kind of flat, like, but that's to be expected. That's to be expected. So I just kind of said, let me just give it some time. Let me just wait a little bit, and you know, clouds will clear up pretty soon. Speaking of that, it rained a little bit here, just enough to barely moisten the pavement. That's not under trees. Under the trees, nothing. But the pavement, just bare pavement with no trees, just barely moistened it. Oh, that's the rain in California. Zero runoff. Zero soaking in. Nothing. Well, got our rain today, you know, 1/1000th of an inch or something like that. Yeah. Wow. Great. That's drought weather. That is the thing. 20-year drought out here. Nobody has a clue what to do about it. Shock treatment for the prime creator is what it is. That's what it is. Hey, prime creator, you created all these bodies. And look what's happened to these bodies. There's horrific drought. You know, you need to wake up and help out, man. Come on. And then people think, well, how come God doesn't help us out in all these situations? What's going on? Look at the history. Look at all the terrible things that have happened. Because we're saying, hey, God, look at what you created, man. Look how terrible. Look what's going on. Horrible situation. You, man, you just got to wake up. You're sleeping. You're not recognizing it properly. It's just an attempt, again, to psych the prime creator out of perfect eternal nowing into believing that it has this future of limitation, ruination. It's like, come on, God, help us out, man. You know, this is your game anyway, so it's up to you to do something about it, kind of thing. God has nothing to do with this dream, nothing to do with it. So again, we've really changed the whole way of looking at the situation. No question about it. We're trying to enlighten the prime creator. What a fantastically helpful perspective this is. It just pushes away magnitudes of difficulty and confusion and delay, because we can't afford to delay anymore, because this dog and pony, we're getting threatened by triple threat of nuclear war. Both the Russians, the North Koreans, and the Chinese are threatening us with nuclear war. Chinese threatening us that they'll waive their pledge to never use nuclear weapons preemptively. But that's off the table when it comes to Taiwan. So if we mess with Taiwan at all, they say we could use nuclear weapons on a first strike. So you have three first strike threats against the United States right now, nuclear weapons. It's worse than the Cold War right now. I grew up in the Cold War. And it's worse. It's worse in a lot of ways right now. It's worse. Because the missiles and the nuclear payload that they have and stuff is just like 100 times worse, or it's just ridiculously advanced. EMPs are also ridiculously advanced. China's extremely advanced in that, as is Russia, but China's super advanced in EMPs, wiping out electrical grids. And so we're in a situation where, we could really be using intense shock treatment on the prime creator at this point. And that's what it would be. And remember, everything that happens here is just our role-playing in an effort to so-called wake up the prime creator out of its dream of delusion of a perfect eternal nowing into the reality of limitation and ruination that this universe is portraying. So if we had some horrible war, again, that would just be shock treatment, like, hey, prime creator, look what's happening to your future. Boy, you can make it better if you just identified with it, if you just woke up out of eternal now perfectioning and recognized, what the hell is going on here, and help us out, then, we would really love you, that kind of thing. We'd really love you if you helped us out with this. See that psych game we're playing? We'd love to love you, Prime Creator, but you're not really helping us out here. You're not identifying it. You're not taking authorship of it. You're what are you doing? You see how we're trying to psych out the Prime Creator by our suffering? We're choosing to suffer. It's 100%. Jesus told us everything we experience is our own choice. We're just acting. Birth, death, aging, everything here is an act. It's just a total act. We're spirit. And spirit is eternal, perfect eternal nowing also. So we're just pretending every last aspect of this universe is mere pretense on our part. But we're trying to say, hey, Prime Creator, look at all this suffering going on. Look at this drought in the Pacific Southwest. This is going to kill so many people. It's going to wipe out civilization. It's going to ruin this. And look at this. Prime Creator, you got to wake up and take risks. Come on, wake up and be responsible. We keep saying that, Don't you want to help us? You're just going to let us die here? Are you kidding me? That's horrible. How can you be loved, if you're this way? We're trying to put a guilt trip on the Prime Creator. Super guilt trip. Trying to put a super guilt trip on the Prime Creator. So this shift is just amazing. First, we have A Course in Miracles is focusing on guilt, but I never related to that in terms of personal guilt. I said that this is not accurate, actually. And now I see there's not about our guilt. We're trying to put a guilt trip on the Prime Creator. That's what's really going on. But Jesus couldn't say that directly. He alluded to this. And wink, wink, nudge, nudge. If you got the ears to hear it, this is where I'm kind of leading you. But it was too difficult for people. So they kept talking about guilt, your own guilt. I feel guilty about something of this, some other person. That's not even happening at all. There's no personal guilt. There's not even any personal persons. It's a cultural thing we're doing. It's a play. We're trying to just convey guilt to the Prime Creator through our acting. Look at all these people out here suffering, you know, and dying and getting sick. Prime Creator, how come you're not helping out? You know, there's something wrong with you. You must be sleeping. You must be ignoring this. You must be deluded. You must be unenlightened. You must, you know, why are you selfishly sticking with this dream of eternal, perfect eternal nowing? Why are you sticking with that and not recognizing, you know, all the misery we're going through here? Wake up, wake up, wake up. It's a guilt trip. It's a guilt trip we're putting on the Prime Creator. So this is just like amazing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Ramaharshi. Thank you, Avatar. Thank you, Padmasambhava, Buddha, Longjampa, Kocha Nilam, and everyone who's helped guide us towards this. But understandably, this is such a complete flipping of the script of the universal script that we've been working on for eons that you have to understand why they had to kind of go slowly on this. And it couldn't just hit us with this, you know, directly. It kind of had to build up bit by bit by bit by bit to make this turnaround. And then this happened finally on July, starting on July 23rd, 2022. Oh, what's this? A bird. What are you doing? Oh, the birds are coming in here. Wow. Yeah, there's a bird at the hummingbird feeder, but there's no food there. I haven't put any food in there. So, this is such a complete flip of recognition now. And that's why Jesus said, you're not really going to be part of A Course in Miracles. Just get the gist of what I'm saying and go really fast. He wanted this big turnaround to happen. And that's why I'm not welcome in Course in Miracles groups or anything at all. Just completely frozen out of it all. Because they don't want to hear this. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear it. They're not ready for it. But we got it here. We got it here. Live. And this is happening live here in the South, beautiful San Francisco, South Bay. And yeah. There's kind of like the West South Bay, the South South Bay, and the East South Bay. We're in the South South Bay right here. The South South Bay area. Yeah. Yeah. And the West area is beautiful too. The East area is beautiful too. The South area is beautiful. It's all one of the most beautiful places on the planet without any question at all. It's just, we're having an amazing summer of just like 82, 84, 82, 82, 84, 80, 84, 82, 84, 85, 84, 82, 85. You know, it's like this. It's like, wow, we wish, weather like this, you just want it to go on forever. You know, it's just like, yeah, give me more of this. Give me more of this. But so if we look at all the suffering in this world that's ever happened as merely our attempt to lay a guilt trip on the Prime Creator, that is a blockbuster recognition, isn't it? A blockbuster recognition. So I have to keep repeating this over and over because people usually only watch about 20 minutes of this, depending on the video, etc. And some less. Because of the people are scared, you know, they're scared to say, Jesus, you know, but gradually we get used to it, and just repeat it, and keep repeating, keep counting, and realize, hey, you know, wow, well, this is very fortuitous, super, super, super fortuitous. Hello, hummingbird, I need to put some sugar in your feed. Okay, you're letting me know that there's no sugar there. Okay, I get it. It's like looking at me like, hey, you know, what's going on here? I got to put some more, I'm almost out of sugar for the hummingbird feeder. Hey, you shouldn't be eating refined sugar, hummingbirds, you know. Let me give you some monk fruit sugar or something like that, you know. Monk fruit sugar, we just got some of that. I haven't tasted it yet. How are we doing here? I don't know. I can't tell. I can't see the how much have we gone through here?
Let me put the hand.
I can't see it all. 50-something, it looks like. Huh. Wow. So, this is amazing. This is terrific. That we're trying to put a guilt trip on the Prime Creator so that it identifies with what's going on here as if it were real. And say, oh, I have a future. It's different than the perfect eternal now. I didn't know that. Thanks for helping me out. Gee, I could have spent all eternity in a state of delusion dreaming of perfect eternal nowing. But now I see that reality is really all this limitation and ruination and tragedy and death and suffering and misery and stuff. Oh, gee, but maybe I can do something about it, you know. But wait a minute. If it comes from me and this is reality, how can I change reality? I can't change reality. Oops. Oh, my God. Oh, it's too terrible to even think about it. I got to self-destruct. Yeah. Okay, hummingbird. I will help you. Yeah. Okay. You're just hovering around me right now. Okay, I got you. I got you. I got your back. There's lots of flowers, though. You know, what are you, lazy? Come on, go get the natural sugar. Look at this refined stuff. It's hurting you. Probably not so great for hummingbirds, right? You're drinking all this super... Well, they're used to sugary stuff, though. Oh, my goodness. So, yeah, I hit my hybrids yesterday, went to the range, thought I'd do great, did terrible, horrible. I couldn't get them any height on them at all. I said, uh-oh, what is it, defective? I said, I got too much money in these, I can't be defective. I got to adjust my swing. So I did adjust my swing and tried this and this and this and this and this. Finally, I got it. How to hit these clubs. Every club, you got to get used to the club. You got to hit a different way. And so then I just started pounding these hybrids, five hybrid. I was just wailing on it and just hitting these terrific, majestic shots, just deep, deep, deep. I don't know. I couldn't see how far they went because the backdrop was such, you couldn't even follow your ball. But I could see they're going out there a good distance. You know, 165, 170, maybe that kind. You're talking about 60s and 70s situation. And then I'd hit the four, little less height to it, but it carried further. You know, overall distance would go further. You could tell that 22 degrees does get a lower trajectory. But I was just hammering them so great. It felt great. So I went from just horrible to great by making this adjustment. I said, wow, boy, I've got to really, you know, emphasize this and open the club face a little bit and come through it like this and sweep it up properly. Can't come down on it with a closed club face. It didn't work at all. Got to launch it with sort of sweeping with sort of a slightly open club face sweeping so it gets the immediate launch. It's not like an iron that you hit it like that and it spins, gives a trajectory. It doesn't spin that much. So by making an adjustment, suddenly my game just completely changed for the better, to be able to hit these shots. Takes the pressure off your driver. You don't have to hit the driver a million miles, even though I found a way that I might be able to do so. We'll see. There is a power move I discovered. There is a power move with the driver. I didn't practice it there because I discovered it when I came home. And I said, because the way I'm hitting it now, it doesn't hit it really far. It's not a super power swing. It's more like an accuracy thing. But sometimes you need to power up. And so I say, okay, let's see if we can find a way to really power up here. And there is a way. And so as my game, I felt like euphoric. You know, I said, my game has changed. Suddenly, I can handle these deep approach shots. I know the swing. I know I can just hammer these things. Wow. Hammer these hybrids. And so here we are now, showing different perspective on the entire situation we have, putting A Course in Miracles even into context and shifting the situation. And I always knew there was some shift, and I was so frustrated with all these people talking about A Course in Miracles, all these so-called teachers and everything. They all were just talking pretty much the same thing. But I just said, that's not it. That's not it. That's not it. It's not about personal guilt. There's no person to have guilt. We're cultural. We're a cultural play. We're putting on a cultural play. We're not separate from culture here. There's no separate identity separate from this play that we're pretending. When you're in a play, everyone's having a role in the play. It's a totality of all the players that are giving this emphasis to the prime creator. It's not just some separate person doing it. It's a collective vibe, so to speak, collective guilt that we're working on here. And so when we see we don't need to do that, that can take place with individuals and pretty much has to. The idea that all the players are suddenly going to realize this, that doesn't seem plausible at all. Yeah, I can't rule it out entirely. Doesn't seem very plausible. But because I'm seeing this right now, and the whole world's not waking, stopping its playing. Its playing is getting more intense. It's getting more intense. Desperate, because we're getting tired of playing these roles. We're getting real tired. Everyone's so tired. There's some in the world that still have a lot of giddy up, you know, but those who've been around the block and done so many different roles, they're super tired of doing this. And so, you know, those souls, so to speak, those facets of spirit, they want to stop this. They want either, you know, let's just succeed finally. Can we just succeed and finish with this? So they're really pushing things. They're really trying utmost to bring about the most horrific guilt in the prime creator. To try to, you know, use guilt as leverage on the prime creator, saying, prime creator, aren't you, you know, how come you're not helping out with this ghastly suffering? The planet's dying. You're not doing anything about it, you know. Well, maybe you don't even exist, that kind of thing. Now we're into that kick, science kick. Like, there's no such thing as the prime creator. It doesn't even exist. If it did, it would take care of this stuff. Obviously, it's not taking care of it, so it must not exist. That's an existential threat to the prime creator, trying to say, hey, prime creator, you know, you probably don't even exist at all. So, you know, wake up from you're really this play of limitation, ruination. So wake up from that so you can have an identity. You don't really have any identity at all as this dream role you're dreaming about. So we're putting this huge pressure on the prime creator. Different kind of pressure. Both kinds are happening now, but a lot of pressure saying, yeah, you don't even exist, prime creator. Why? See, whole planet's going to get destroyed and you're not doing anything to help. And Jesus tells us, look, in an instant, you could have whatever planet you want, the planet condition, whatever you want it to be, and it would instantly be in that condition. You're not subject to any ruination at all here. It's just all play acting. Nothing's subject to ruination. Just we're the ones dreaming. It's not dreaming, it's play acting. So again, trying to lay a guilt trip on the prime creator and trying to lay an intense guilt trip on the prime creator. I'm not into that at all. I'm being honest with the prime creator and saying, prime creator, this is all just a completely useless exercise of futility, unnecessary. We made it all up. We made a mistake. You know, we can forgive ourselves and let's get back to experiencing reality the way it actually is and stop this nonsense. And so the Holy Spirit will help out. The Holy Spirit, again, says, let's hedge our bets here. Okay, hedge our bets. We don't have to decide right now which side is true. But let's get this experience of feeling really close to reality, perfect eternal nowing. Wow. Let's get experience real close to that with pretending. Okay, and then at that point, we're in a strong position, right? We can see, you know, does this help the prime creator wake up from his delusion? Or does this help us let go of our delusion that we need to wake up the prime creator from a delusion? We'll be like, you know, in the perfect position to go either way at that point. Right now, we're doubling down on just, you know, a hard sell situation. What if we're wrong about this? See, it's extremely risky, crazy situation we're engaging in right now, that we're not even giving any latitude to the possibility that we could be mistaken about this whole situation. We don't even need to do this. We're trying to convince ourselves, we're trying to act as if for sure we have to do this and succeed at this. No question about it. Can't even think about the possibility it isn't. So that's a, you know, very harsh, extremely unwise position to put ourselves in. That's why I'm saying I don't want to be, you know, put in this type of position. It's horrible. It's the worst position ever to take, just to try to produce mass horrific guilt in the Prime Creator. What if the Prime Creator isn't dreaming? What if we made a mistake? You know, we're just torturing ourselves needlessly, playing this torturous roles for no reason whatsoever, and reinforcing our continuity fear, our paranoia that if we stop doing this, we can't function. So we're just creating massive delay also to letting go of this silliness. So let's hedge our bets properly here. You know, hedge our bets properly. Let the Holy Spirit hedge our bets for us. Let the Holy Spirit hedge our bets for us. Let's play this situation wisely right now. So I'm of a mind that, again, we don't need to do this at all. And I'm, you know, 99.99% certain of it. But even so, let's hedge our bets. I'm willing to hedge my bets with this. Nothing to lose. We'll be in a perfect position either way. We go either way, right? Instead of all this, you know, just, you know, jackbooted, lockstepping, you know, marching to doom in the world right now. We don't need to do that. That's not the wisest play at all. So get wise. Don't wake up. Get wise. You know, be wise. Forget about waking up. Let's first be wise about the situation. Turn our futuring over to the Holy Spirit. Let it fashion this facsimile of a perfect eternal nowing. And from there, we can reassess. We'll reassess. Do we really need to do this? If we do, this would be a good place to start, right? Be nice to the Prime Creator. Hey, Prime Creator, we got something that's really similar to what you're used to, you know, that kind of thing. That would put us in an ideal situation if we did have to wake the Prime Creator up. It would put us in an ideal situation to start succeeding at that, right? Either way. But then, and if we don't need to, ideal situation to let go of our attempt to wake up the Prime Creator. Ideal situation either way. It's a surreal day here. It really is. So we have jumped ahead now, jumped really very, very effectively into looking at the situation as a guilt trip, you know, trying to guilt the Prime Creator into identifying with what's going on here. Wow. We're trying to enlighten the Prime Creator. We're putting on an act, trying to succeed at this. And now we're seeing that we're trying to get the Prime Creator to identify with what's going on, and we're trying to get to identify through either, like, look how happy we are, why don't you identify with our happiness, or now we're using a look how miserable we are, how come you won't help us out, you know, we're your children, you're not helping us out, this is just, I can't believe you're like this, you know, I know many of us, I've felt this way in my life, wait, Prime Creator, what are you doing, I'm suffering so bad, you're not helping me out at all, I said, this is crazy, something just, I don't know, what's, and now we know it's all an act, our suffering is just a total act. And that's all that it is. It's all fake. It's all fake news. It's all universe is fake news, actually. Whole universe is fake news. We're waking up to fake news, you know, gradually, right? There's so much fake news going on, it's just incredible. If you say anything true, there's all these fact checkers. Everyone leaps out and says, I am fact checking this and this is false. They're just part of the fake news. All the fact checkers for fake news, they themselves are fake news. Nothing to see here. You know, nothing to see here. Wait a minute, you know. Look at those eyes. They're not blinking. They're not even moving. In fact, there's zero movement in any of the musculature of the eyes or the pupils or nothing. Nothing's moving. It's completely static. As somebody, it's like, what? That's not possible. That's CGI. I mean, what? And you're telling us this is the leader of the free world, you know? It's like a digital image. CGI. What the heck is going on here? Blink. You know, can you blink a few times? No. Yeah. Like this. The police. Horrible police, you know, just completely gaslighting the whole country, gaslighting with eyes like this. It's kind of hard to do. I don't know. There's got to be some movement. How do you get the eyes, you know, just complete, I don't know. Voice is deeper too. Deep voice like this. And doesn't look real. Something is, the ears are different. This is different. This is different. The hair is parted the opposite direction. What? You know, how many guys do you know get up every morning and say, let me part my hair completely opposite of the way I've parted my whole lifetime. Yeah, and I'll switch back the next day. I'll just part my hair. That doesn't happen. Hair is part in the opposite direction. Whoops. Wardrobe malfunction. You know, somebody got that one wrong. Someone's head's going to roll over that one. You know, what do they have, the person, continuity director, you know, has to make sure there's perfect continuity in all the shots in a movie. Otherwise, people say, wait a minute, this is all fake. So, didn't get the hair, you got the hair part in the opposite direction with this, either an actor or CGI, or both. Someone missed that. And, oh, the ears don't match up even, you know, at all. It's like, whoops. missed that one too. They got some buffoons, you know, running things. And it's like, what the heck is going on here? Well, now we know. We know it's just a collective effort to enlighten the prime creator. We're working towards a super guilt trip. We really are working towards a super guilt trip. Holy Spirit, I'm homeless. I'm dying. How come you're not helping me out? Sort of thing. So this is helpful for me because I've realized that the scripting of the roles that we have is such that it goes towards trying to create a super guilt trip. Super guilt trip. Oh, you know, I'm one of those who paid most attention to you, Prime Creator, and look, you're not taking care of me at all. You're not doing anything to help me. This is horrible. How can you do such a thing? That's a guilt trip. So in seeing this now, we can start giving up our guilt tripping, and this opens up the possibility that our in our futuring we can have a, you know, terrifically supported, wonderful experience. Doesn't have to be such that we say, oh, thank you, Prime Creator, look at this experience you're giving me. You know, you got to identify with this. It's so wonderful, you know. It doesn't have to be like that. And we can see through that also. But it certainly doesn't have to be a guilt trip. Any effort we make to get the Prime Creator to identify with limitation and ruination is just our attempt to enlighten the Prime Creator to wake up to our make-believe future that we believe it has in order to get it to self-destruct. But it won't identify. Prime Creator does not identify with this universe. That's what Jesus told us. Does not in any way ever identify with this universe whatsoever. How about that for a hint from Jesus? Yeah, big hint. Not everybody took this hint. But he said, told me, go fast, get the gist of it. Just get the essence of it here. Forget about the words. That's not for you. Come on, hurry up, like that. That's what Jesus told me. So hint, no identification with this universe by the Prime Creator, zero. So it can't be real. It can't be real at all. It's all make-believe. But we certainly don't want to guilt trip the situation at all. We don't want to guilt trip the situation at all. So, Holy Spirit, turn this our future of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will give us a future that's extremely close to reality. Extremely close to reality. Eternal, it feels like almost perfect eternal nowing. You know, it seems very close to it. Very close to it. As if it were like a dream of that or a facsimile of it. Holy Spirit's capable of doing that. So we feel this is the remedy. This is what we should be aiming towards right now. Yeah. So huge day. I was kind of wondering, you know, where do we go yesterday? I say, what's next? I can't quite see it. And now, boom, this whole guilt tripping thing, get the Prime Creator to identify with this somehow. You're killing me, Prime Creator. Just killing me. You know, what are you doing? You know, why do you keep doing this? You know, it's horrible. If you just woke up and identified with this, you know how to help me out. It's the Holy Spirit that helps us out. It's already helped us out to stop this silly game that we're playing, you know, the silliness that we're engaged in. How are we doing here? 1, 2, 1:13. Oh, we got a little time. Yeah. So I'm doing a pretty good job of not getting sidetracked, I'd say. Under the circumstances, maybe a terrific job. Because the intent, the pressure on me, you know, is so intense to make this breakthrough that, you know, the thoughts of like, maybe I should just distract myself with stuff that's, you know, frivolously amusing or entertaining or whatever. But I've kind of been saying, no, not right now. And actually staying on track. Pretty well, in fact, maybe very well. This, you know, temptations to go into side tripping are everywhere here. You're like walking through a minefield, actually, a minefield of distractions here. But so far so good, and we're tipping the whole thing, you know, in the right direction right now. The whole thing's already been tipped, tipping you off, tipping everybody off to the situation that's going on. And again, indeed, the world is weird. If you notice, like, hey, the world is just like, this is just, don't like it. No, hardly anybody likes it. And then, you know, half of the people say, this is totally weird, this is crazy. The other half goes, nothing to see here. What are you talking about? Nothing to see here. Everything's just going great. You know, yeah, everything's fine and wonderful. You know, what? What? So you get that. So there's nothing you say to these people at all, right? From that standpoint, they're just like, what are you talking about? You're crazy or something? Everything's great. Everything's fine. I mean, everything's going exactly the way we want it to go. And you know, well, yeah. You know, in other words, the play is going along exactly how they want it to go. Let's cause just incredible misery in the world. Guilt tripping. Now, religion tries to produce like, hey, look how happy we are, God. We're deliriously happy. We're so thrilled that you made us as human beings and put us in this world full of death and ruination. We're just loving it, you know. We praise you day and night for doing this. You're so wonderful. And by the way, you know, could you make us a little more prosperous? Could you make us a little, you know, more happier? Just a tiny bit, tiny, tiny bit. You know, we love what you've done so far. If you could just do a little bit more, then we'd just love you, you know, totally. That's trying to, what do you call it, honeypot the Prime Creator, you know. It's just like, hey, we just love you so much. Love bomb the Prime Creator. Let's say, just trying to love bomb the Prime Creator. And it's just, oh, it's just praise. But you know what? It's not perfect. My love for you is not perfect yet. So if you could just help us out a little bit, you know, with this ruination limitation and kind of adjust it in a little certain way, then we'd like totally love you. It'd be total love. It'd be perfect love. You'd never see the end of the love. Wow. That's just the flip side of guilt tripping. It's just the opposite of guilt tripping. The same principles at work. The very same principles at work. That's why I never try to love God. I've never tried to do that. And I've experienced reality. And I realize what happens is you feel perfectly suited for reality. It's a feeling of this perfect suitability. And you could say you feel this extreme confidence, which some people call that love. When I say I just love this, meaning I feel totally suited for this and totally confident I can function this way. And I love harmonizing. I love this confidence, you know, this super confidence more than anything that you can function in reality. When you reach reality, it's not all this love that we're thinking of or anything like that. It's a suitability. You say, hey, you know, I got this, I feel totally functional here. I feel totally inclusiveness. I feel like I can creatively harmonize with everything. And you say, I realize I got the functionality I need. This is terrific. I love this functionality. It's a functionality issue. So again, we see all this attempt to love God. as a attempt to trap God, love bombing, deception. It's just the same type of deception, deceptiveness as guilt tripping God. So we're either like, you know, suffering so bad, or we're just, you know, so desirous. We just want to love you, God. That's all we want to do. All you got to do is identify with this dream, this scheming. All you got to do is identify with limitation and nation. All you got to do is wake up from your dreaming of eternal now perfectioning. That's all you got to do. And we'll love you so much for doing that. You don't, you know, we'll give you total love forever as long as you wake up from your dream of perfect eternal now and nowing. We'll just totally love you for that. And the other way is to say, we're going to hate you forever, God, if you don't help us. You know, we're going to turn our backs on you. You know, you're just the worst God ever. You're not even helping us. We're suffering so bad. It's horrible. How can you possibly? You can redeem yourself, though, if you help us out. We will give you redemption for that. They're two sides of the same coin of trying to psych out the Prime Creator, trying to enlighten the Prime Creator. Two sides of the very same coin. So I certainly don't do bhakti, and don't do what would be the suffering one, yoga. You know, don't do either bhakti or yoga, or you know, asceticism or anything like that. Just both are exactly the same scheme, same scheme, same scheme, same scheme. Wow. So this puts us in a really good situation right now. Super great situation to see this, to be able to see this, be able to put it into words, be able to explain it clearly here. Even though we might say, this is so new, you know, we might go full POTUS, you know. What do they do? Botox his eyes? You know, like, I can't move my eyes. They're completely Botoxed. You know, or was he on fentanyl or something? I don't know what they got him on. He's got a lot of people on fentanyl in the country right now. He's got over like 100,000 overdoses going on in the country, dying. These are like teenagers who have parents and brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, nieces and nephews, cousins, etc. Not nieces and nephews, cousins. They've got relatives, let's put it that way. They've got young people having all sorts of relatives, grandparents, uncles, aunts and uncles. You could say, yeah, cousins, nieces and nephews, brothers and sisters, parents, friends of parents, friends, lots of friends. Like they have friends in high school and stuff. These people that are overdosing are usually like in high school or college. They got a huge number of friends. How do you think how do you think the friends feel when they find out their dear, you know, part of their inner, you know, friendship circle is just died from fentanyl? So every fentanyl death is affecting a huge circle of people, and it's just traumatizing them so terribly. Because it was just one silly mistake they made. You know, they're good kids. They just went to a party and someone, you know, maybe they're drinking alcohol or something, and someone offered them a pill and says, yeah, I took one, I'm feeling great. And they take a pill. 2 out of 5 pills have fentanyl in it, potentially lethal doses of fentanyl in it, that street drugs. And even they look like pharmaceutical grade drugs. They look like they're legitimate drugs because they're making fakes that look just exactly the same as the drugs you get in your pharmacy. The kid takes one of them. It's got too much fentanyl in it, which is very easy to get because the way they mix these things is not precise at all. In Mexico, they're making the drugs in Mexico. So Mexico's culpable too. And he's dead. Person's dead. The teenager, the young person between the ages of 16 and 40 is a leading cause of death in the country. And then nobody says, you know, the administration is like, what are you talking about? You know, everything's fine. Everything's perfect, man. Well, trying to guilt the Prime Creator. Look what you're doing, Prime Creator. You're allowing this fentanyl crisis to devastate us. Is it trying to guilt trip the Prime Creator, isn't it? It's exactly what's going on. Identify with this dream and help us immediately. We're all dying from fentanyl here. Wow. but don't take pills. Don't take drugs at all. They're putting it in marijuana now, the fentanyl. They're putting it in everything because it's super cheap. It's super cheap because it's so potent. You can cut it and cut it and cut it, and it's still extremely potent. It's cheap, and it's potent, and it's cuttable. So you make vast profits off of this because you get super high from this, just a tiny bit, so super high. People think they're getting really strong drugs, and they'll pay good price, expensive prices for them. So these drug dealers are making massive amounts of money off of this. But the bigger picture is it's just a collective guilt-tripping situation. If we look at it, that's the truth of the situation. Now, we don't minimize the suffering that the relatives and friends and family go through. But keep in mind that they're also trying to guilt-trip the prime creator. Spirit has never been born or died. These are just dream characters that we're associating with here. These are just simple, they're just make-believe dream characters. We could bring them to life in an instant if we wanted to. Jesus did. Jesus brought his dream character body back to life. He said, I just chose to do so. You can do so also if you want to. But beyond that is much more teaching of why we even have a dream character, make-believe dream character body in the first place. Right? Now we know. So this whole fentanyl thing is an extreme guilt-tripping thing we're doing on the prime creator. Extreme. There'll be other stuff coming along too. But, just the whole opioid crisis, OxyContin opioid crisis also. I think there's like 600,000 people died so far, if not more, from OxyContin. Talk about the devastation in communities and families and friends and relatives from that. Okay. That's extreme guilt tripping also. All suffering is guilt tripping. And even all happinessing is also deceptioning in this universe, you might say, deceptioning. But the Holy Spirit will give us one final deception, which from which standpoint we can decide either to go with more deception or to drop the deception altogether. Okay, so this facsimile that's almost like reality. That too is a deception. But it's the one deception that is most easy for us to drop deception altogether at that point. We say, we don't even need deception. That this has all been entirely unnecessary. And once we feel confident that we can function in reality, then we're really going to look very clearly at what we've been doing. And so that's what happened with me in having these revelations where I experienced reality directly. I've had a number of these instances, actually, experiences. I became so confident I can function in reality. I experienced it. I say, wow, I can do this. Then I was willing then to look at this situation to the utmost clarity like this and spill the beans entirely on what's going on because I'm not worried about functioning in reality. I said, I'm pretty darn assured that I can. It's automatic. It's automatic. You don't have to think about it. There's no scheming involved. You just are made to function in reality perfectly well. All of us are. So there's really no difficulty whatsoever. You don't have to think about how do I do this. You just say, I know I can do this. You just know it. You just know it and you just do it. It's like singing. If I hear a song, I know I can sing to this song. I don't think about it at all. I don't have to give one thought to it, really. I just, boom, here we go. I just want to. I say, I just feel like singing. And I just, boom, sing. Yeah, it's like that, except infinitely more assurance. Your confidence is just perfect. You have perfect confidence. So there we go, about the end of this video. So this is like, the best video ever for sure. And like best video ever. Got a new hat to celebrate the day, right? I had a feeling something good was coming. Might as well do some styling while we're at it. Because this is the greatest video ever. The best information I think ever given out in the world. This is how I feel about it. It's what I want to hear. It's what I love to hear. I haven't got quite this from any of the past teachings. So I said, I got to say it because, it's just not being said. I can't wait around during these times and just read the same old stuff from the past where it's not really there. Let me get it there right here, right now. Let's do it. Let's do it. And we've done it. And thank you for watching. It's been a pleasure to be able to share this with you. And for your consideration, you say, this is worth considering. Wow. Yes, yes, yes. Wow, wow, wow. Yes, 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 yes. Wow. Past is wow. Present is wow. Future is wow.